Welcome, first of all, to the Weather API, Weather Provider API webinar. Good afternoon, or good morning, or evening, depending on where you are. Welcome to the webinar. As I said, we are very happy to have you all here. We are with a large group from various companies, so that's a great thing. I believe this is the first, or one of the first, external webinars that Alliander is hosting, so that's a bit exciting and new for us, so bear with us as we go along, but we're looking forward to it and excited to go along. Just a quick heads up that this webinar is being recorded and shared online afterwards, so if you have any issues with that, which we can imagine, please just turn off your camera. I think that might be best. Also, please mute your microphone so we can only hear the speaker. Thank you for that. So for now, again, welcome. And let me introduce the agenda for today and the team. The webinar itself consists of two parts. The first part, and the second part, which is logical. But the first part, we'll dive into a bit about what Alliander as a company is, which I will introduce to you. But also on the webinar, or the Weather Provider API itself, Johan Ressing, my colleague, will introduce the API to you, as well as some user cases. And to dig a little deeper into how we as Alliander use the Weather Provider API and the weather data itself, we are happy to have Sander Rieke here to tell us more about Smart Cable Guard and the way he uses data in his analyses. In the second part, my colleague Raoul Linnenbank will take us on a deep dive into the techniques, such as the methods and the formats that have been used to build the API. So thank you all for speaking today. We've had a long time to prepare. It's finally here, and we're very excited to host this webinar. My name is Judith, which you can see in the screen on Microsoft Teams, which is very easy, I think. I'm the host for today. I will also be telling you a bit more about Alliander's open source mission, but more on that later. If you've only signed up for part one, feel free to leave in the break that we will have in the middle of the webinar. And as said, we will post this webinar online and send you the presentation slides as well afterwards. So feel free to take print screens, but we will also send them afterwards. With regards to questions, you're very welcome to ask questions. Please do so in the chat function of the Microsoft Teams thing. We will have ample time to answer the questions at the end of the first part and at the end of the second part. Please be patient if we don't answer immediately, but we will, and otherwise we will come back to that afterwards. So I guess that's it for the introduction. I will now move on to Alliander itself. For those of you who do not know, because we are with a group of various companies, as I said, and not all from the energy world. Alliander is a network company, and for Dutch people, I think Liander is most known. Our mission is to keep the lights on and the houses warm, and we are situated all over the Netherlands, which you can see. Our electricity grid length, to give you an example, is 92,000 kilometers long, which runs all over the Netherlands. So that's a big responsibility to keep the lights on. We are the largest DSO in the Netherlands, and we have 5.8 million customer connections. So that's quite a bit. Our mission is to stand for energy supply that gives everyone equal access to reliable, affordable, and renewable energy, which is in these days very important, I think. And in our strategy, we have digitalization as one of the four pillars, which, well, is one of the reasons we are here today. We see open source software as a way to, as a part of this digitalization strategy. But I will come back to that a bit later on in the webinar. What you can see in the energy transition is that there will be greater peak loads on the electricity grid, which is why we need to think of more solutions, smart solutions, to figure out what we are doing. The energy transition is going so much faster than we would have thought 40 years ago. So we are facing immense challenges, and we have to face them together. Because you might say, hey, why have this webinar in English? You're a Dutch energy company, why bother? Well, I think the energy transition does not end at country borders. All over the world, we are facing the same issues, and we should face these challenges together. For Alliander, facing these challenges means that we are participating in open source software, and that's one way for us to cooperate and to find solutions together. But again, more on that later. I would now like to give the floor to Johan, who will take us with him into the world of the Weather Provider API.
Yes, thank you, Judith, and thank you everyone for being here. My name is Johan Reffing. I work at Alliander as a data scientist, and I will introduce the Weather Provider API today. So in my part, I will discuss a couple of things. Firstly, why we built this API, what it does, and also a short demonstration of how you can use it yourself. Then some use cases. But first, I know that not everyone here has a technical background, so I will shortly also go into what actually is an API, because I think that's probably also something to something useful to have a clear idea of. So if we can go to the next slide. Yes, so what is an API? Well, API is an acronym for Application Programming Interface. And broadly speaking, an API enables interactions between applications. So these days, everything is connected. So your phone connects to databases and applications, but all these systems don't necessarily know how to speak with each other. And APIs enable those interactions by being sort of the link between those applications. And if system A wants to speak to system B, and instead, system A speaks to the API, and the API can translate the requests and pass those translated requests through to system B and sort of mediate the interaction between all the applications. And there is actually a common analogy for this, which we can discuss, and that is the analogy of an API. It's the restaurant analogy. So let's imagine you are hungry and you sit down at a restaurant and you see the kitchen where they deliver the food and you would like to order some food. Well, usually how it goes is that you don't directly walk to the kitchen and order something like a bagel, but rather you would wait for the waiter, and the waiter would take your order, translate that to something the kitchen will understand, and pass that on to the kitchen. Kitchen prepares the food, and the waiter brings back the food. So here in this analogy, you have two systems and the API being the waiter. If we can go to the next slide again. What we have built is also an API, but actually our API is slightly different. It doesn't quite fit that analogy, because what our API does is it retrieves data from many different data sources. So in the analogy, that would be restaurants. So our API can retrieve data from weather sources, from the KNMI, quite a few actually, but also from the climate data store. So in that sense, our API is not necessarily a waiter, but maybe a delivery person from Deliveroo or Uber Eats or whatever service you use to order from many different restaurants. So hopefully that gives you a bit of an idea of what an API is and also already what our API does. So let's take a look at why we want to build such an API. So what you see in practice, you have many data sources, and those data sources often also have multiple data models. And each of these models can you can get data from either through an API or maybe from the website itself or through some other form. But between those sources or even between the models, usually what you get is in a very different form, not necessarily standardized. Sometimes it's also you have to do quite a bit of research on how to exactly interpret things and how to process them. So what we want is to make that process easier. So if you can click once, we have a small example of an Harmony Rome data set provided by the KNMI, the Royal National Meteorological Institute. And the Harmony Rome data model gives us 48-hour predictions of the data, of the weather. And these are given to us in archives of 48 grid files each, and of which the first actually contains two grids rather than one. So for this, you would have to figure out how to work with grid files and also look what is in each specific grid file, which can be hard. If you can click again. And then once more. Then we see another source. So this is another data model that we support. So here we have hourly data, which is provided by the KNMI, and that's provided per weather station. So let's say you want to know the temperature at a specific location. Then what you would have to do in this case is match that location to a weather station, and then look at what the code is of that weather station and figure out how to get data for that specific weather station. And then there are more examples. So here we have from the website of the KNMI, you can also find 15-day predictions. So these are directly from the web page and also per weather station. And then we also have data from the climate data store. And they give us grid files or NetCDF. And these, to retrieve this data, can actually also be quite difficult because you have to make a selection based on location, which is an area. And then the time selection also does not always work very intuitively. So our takeaway from this is that we kind of want to simplify this whole process of retrieving the weather data and making one easy method to retrieve data from any of these sources. And for this, and this is exactly what our Weather API does. So we have a couple of goals that we wanted this API to fulfill. We wanted one method with which you can retrieve all this data. We wanted the retrieval to be fast, in some cases even faster than using the APIs of the sources directly. Clear and consistent in what in and outputs are. So the inputs are fixed, and you can just say, I want this source and then this location, and the API will do the rest. Also, of course, easily expandable with new models, new sources. We now have only data models from KNMI and a climate data store. But you could imagine that you would want to expand this, for example, with a weather model from Germany or Belgium or anywhere. And we want that process to be easy as well. Well, we want to be able to handle slower sources. So in some cases, if you want a little bit of data, you have to download a bunch of data and then extract whatever you want. You want to be able to do that in a fast way, while storing as little as possible data. And of course, we want to give you the data in the way you like it. So if you like to work with JSON, then, well, that's an option. But if you prefer CSV or NetCDF, then that's an option as well. And of course, scalability is always important. Just having easy way to work, easy way to expand your models and keeping them running fast. So those are the goals. But why do we actually build this API? Is there no other API that already does this, maybe? And as far as we know, to our knowledge, there's no open source or publicly available API that already does this in the way we want it. You could use the individual APIs, and that's of course an option. If you only want to use data from one model, you can definitely do that, but it will probably take a bit longer to do so. And really, this API is just great for if you want to build something quick, if you don't want to spend a lot of time on retrieving data and processing data and getting all the setup done. So it's great for prototyping or proof of concept and quick implementations. And it's also good for larger projects, but you do have to be aware that we do not know everything. So we are, of course, limited by the data sources. Let's say, for example, the KNMI, they provide uurgegevens or hourly data based on weather stations or from weather stations. We can couple your location to a weather station automatically, but that does not mean that we know the temperature data of every square meter in the Netherlands. We are still limited by the sources. So if you have a critical application, make sure you understand what you are using. Well, that's a short disclaimer I did want to put out there. So now let's look at what our ActionAI API actually does. And there are basically four stages when you make a request. First is gathering the data. Then we convert the data to X-ray format. Once that's done, we harmonize the array. So we convert labels and units to a standard unit, and then we convert the X-ray to the desired output type and return that to the user. So now let's look a little bit more in depth at each step. So at the first step, we gather the data either from the source or from storage. So some data we actually do store. For example, some data is released periodically. In those cases, we already retrieve that data periodically and prepare it and store it so that when a request is made, we can very quickly give back the data without having to first get it from the source and then return it. We then, once we have the data, we convert it to an X-ray, a set. And where necessary, that data was already stored to minimize overhead time. And next step, yes. Then we want to harmonize the data, because we want to we want you to know what to expect. So sometimes labels can be unclear or hard to interpret without further documentation. In those cases, we try to make those labels more clear. Units are converted to, per default converted to SI units, so the International System of Units, which is almost a worldwide standard, with the exceptions of the US, Liberia, and Myanmar. But other than those three countries, it's worldwidely adopted, and also even in these countries, in academia, it's commonly used. So once those conversions are done, we we package the data however you like it. Currently supported are JSON datasets, NetCDF3 and 4, and CSV. And then we deliver the output to the person making the request. So that's what the API does. So if you go to the next slide, I think it's time for a short demonstration. And for that, I will attempt to take control. Yes. So
yeah,
you're hosted. Yes, it works. We've hosted the Weather API at this address, so if you were to try this yourself, you could. It's reachable for anyone. So if you forgot what models are supported, you can use this endpoint. Press try it out, execute, and you will see which data sources and which models we support. It's from the Kanemi. We have the hourly data, daily data, the Aurum data, plume data, and actual observations. Then from the climate store, we also have the ERA5 single level data. Now, if you actually want to use this data, then you can use this endpoint. It's going a bit slow on my screen, but yes, we can try this out. So here's the how you would use it. You just fill out whichever data you like. So we could, for example, look at the hourly data from the Kanemi. And if we scroll down a bit further, you can choose how much data you want to retrieve from two. So let's just take 1 day at this location. Then here you can choose your units of choice. So the SI is the International System of Units. Human units are a bit more intuitive. It's basically the same as SI, except that temperatures are in Celsius rather than Kelvin. And precipitation is in millimeters rather than meters. And original is just the original data. So if we look at that first. And we select JSON so that it's easily readable. Well, then first you get the request URL. So if you are a developer, you can just use this within your application to retrieve the data. And then here you have the original data. So with the... Yes. With the original labels and original units. So if you go to the Kanemi website, it's all documented and you can figure out what exactly is in there. But you can also choose to let us convert this to other units and other labels. And in that case, we have converted most of the columns to easily interpretable names. So temperature, it's just easy to find now. It's easy to, well, this is 281 Kelvin, so you can always expect the temperatures to be in Kelvin. And, well, you can choose whatever you want to use this for. So now, let's say you want a different model. So you, rather than the hourly data, you want the daily data. Then all you need to do is change the model. Execute it again, and now you have the daily data from a totally different model, still within the same source though, but also again converted units, converted labels, easy to use. Now let's say you want even a different source, so we look at the climate data store, and we want the ERA5 single level data set. And all you need to do is change the model, change the source, execute again. And then you have the data that you need. All converted, all the same units, very easy to use. So say you are making a quick project and for some reason you need soil temperature to maybe see if there's a correlation between soil temperature and I don't know, some phenomenon you have observed, then you can quickly just use this URL, retrieve the data, run a correlation, and basically you're done. So as you can see, it's very easy to retrieve the data from many different sources. It's all with the same method, You just have to change the URL to have the right parameters. So you can change the location, change the units, change the output format. And that's all you need to do. So I think that's enough for a short demo of the API. So this is just the front end. If you want to use the application itself, you can also query multiple locations at once. But this UI only supports one location at a time.
So, it might be good to explain as well that the things you're filling in there, so the KNMI uurgegevens, daggegevens, so the hourly data, daily data, the explanation of what you have to fill in the various boxes can also be found on our website. So that yes. might mean something for those of you who are lost and thinking, what do I need to fill in? That might be a good way to start.
Yes. Yeah. At the top, there was also this the sources endpoint where you could find look up which sources and models were supported. But it's also on the website and I think on the README, on the GitHub page as well. So plenty of ways to figure it out.
Great.
I think we can go back to the slides.
I got two questions, by the way.
Sure.
Do you need to know the specific grid raster for each weather model? And what happens if you insert a latitude-longitude combination, which is somewhere right in between? Does it interpolate to that point or not?
So the second question, does it interpolate or not? At this point, it looks at the closest weather station and returns that the weather from that weather station. So it does not interpolate at this point. But that is something that we were thinking about implementing. So it could very easily be added, or even if you don't want to wait for us, you could just fork the repository and implement it yourself.
Oh, okay, yeah. In Xarray is a very easy interpolation method, by the way.
Yes.
Second, I saw the timestamp didn't contain a time zone, which is always peculiar with weather data because it's mostly UTC. And if you don't know, well, you don't know.
Yes.
Is that somewhere mentioned? Because I didn't see when you made the example. Maybe it is, but I didn't see it.
So this one I will pass to Raoul.
Okay.
Yes, I'll gladly answer that question. Everything is reformatted into UTC, regardless of what it was before. And as far as the division of hours is concerned, the 11th hour we consider to be from 11 to 12, as opposed to some sources that might use the 11th hour as from 10 to 11.
Okay.
All right, thank you for your questions. Are there any more questions on this part of the webinar? No, we have ample time later on, so that's fine.
Yes.
Let's move on, I think, to current applications of the API within MLM.
Yes.
Judith, there was one additional question coming in.
Yes.
From Eric, is there only Dutch weather info?
At this moment, yes. So, very small disclaimer that some small parts of Belgium and Germany may also be included at the border, but for the most part, yes, for all practical purposes. But the point is that we hope that us making this open source and also making it easy to extend on this, that if you require some weather data from, for example, Germany, and you have a weather source, that it is easy to implement and add that on to this to the API. But at this point, yes, only Dutch weather data is supported.
Okay.
Great. So current applications of the API within Alliander. So of course, this API has now existed for some time, and there have already been some applications of the API, and I will discuss those shortly. So one example is, for example, when we have voltage complaints. So sometimes a client calls us and says, well, some of my devices aren't working properly. Then we can automatically use the Weather API to retrieve solar radiation data and see whether that could be caused by, for example, too high voltages caused by solar panels at his connection or somewhere in that street. We are already doing that. Another application would be short-term load forecasting. So if we have hourly data predictions for maybe 2 or 10 days, then we can use wind speeds and solar radiation and maybe other factors even to predict how much distributed load generation there is at different connections. Our short asterisk, this could be a use case. Currently, they already do this, but they don't use the Weather API because they already implemented getting the data from Kanami before the Weather API existed. But if they would do it now, they would have used the API. So the first use case would be calculating cable temperatures. So we have, of course, many cables, and how much loads we can put on those cables depends on the temperature they reach given those loads. And one important factor in what those loads or what the temperatures will be are soil moisture levels and soil temperatures. So that data is also easily retrievable. And the fourth application is Smart Cable Guard. And for Smart Cable Guard, we today have a guest speaker, Sander Rieke, who has prepared a short presentation about how they use weather data and how Smart Cable Guard helps us at Alliander.
Thank you for the introduction, Johan. So maybe it's good to start by explaining what Smart Cable Guard is. So as a grid operator, we operate the medium voltage grid, amongst other things, also the low voltage grid, but that's now beyond scope for this talk. And unfortunately, sometimes you have a power failure in the medium voltage grid. And what happens then sometimes is that you have a power failure that happens, for example, because a cable joint, which is a piece that connects two cables, breaks down. And what happens sometimes before it actually breaks down is that inside the cable joint, you have small sparks. And that can be weeks, months, sometimes even years before the actual breakdown occurs. Now then, wouldn't it be great if you would be able as a grid operator to detect those small sparks, because then you could take preventive action and remove the joint actually before it fails, and thus preventing an actual power outage. And this is precisely what we have Smart Cable Guard for. This is a sensor that detects small sparks that often precede these failures in the cable joints. We have now more than 1800 of these sensors. And how it works is as follows. You see here a picture that's quite complicated, but let me explain. So you see here three houses. Those are secondary substations. And in between, there's a cable. And around the cable, we put the sensor, which is basically a coil. Now, if there is a small spark, a partial discharge, we call it, somewhere between the two sensors, it will send a small current that runs along the cable, not through the conductor, but along the cable sheath. It arrives at both coils. They both pick up the signal. The two sensors also communicate, so they know how long it normally takes for signal to reach from one to the other. And with that information, it can actually compute the location where the small spark occurred. And not only the location, it can also detect the charge that was discharged. And so the sensor picks it up, it registers this data, and in certain intervals, it will send this data to the data collection center. And that arrives at our team. And that's the data that we analyze to try to find the weak spots in the grid where the faults are likely to occur so that we can take preventive action. Now we can go to the next slide. Yes. So I mentioned we have 1800 of these systems that are active currently, And last year, we managed to prevent 50 power outages based on the data that this system generates. And we also monitor 5,000 kilometers of cable. Now, this seems like a large amount, but actually, like Judith explained, we have much more cables than this, but we place the sensors in the best possible circuits, so that and those are the circuits that have the largest expected customer outage duration. So we try to be smart about that, because we cannot monitor the whole grid, unfortunately. Now, the data looks like the picture on the right. Every dot is actually a measurement, and such a measurement has a location somewhere along the cable. It has a timestamp and it has a charge. And this is actually an example from practice. And you see a lot of dots, and it looks a bit chaotic. It's not easy to make sense out of this. So that's why we need quite sophisticated models to actually analyze this data. And you can also do it by eye. You can have special operators that are trained to look at pictures like this, and they can actually see by eye what you need to do. This has already also been done the last few years, but one of the missions of our team at Alliander is to do this automatically, which is much more efficient, but also better. So, like I mentioned, the dots are the measurements, and you also see some colors in there, and those are actually the results of one of our models. So the colors are assigned to the dots that supposedly belong to each other, that form a cluster. And these are the interesting places that we want to examine further. Because if there's a failure expected, you will see clusters of activity before it happens at that certain location. And of course, if we decide to take preventive action, we also want to validate that we picked out the right place in the grid. So we have a mechanic that goes there, and often the cable joint is removed and also examined. And that's the picture on the right, where you actually see, if you look closely, a crack along one of the conductors. So this was actually a successful application of the system. Now, I mentioned that we need sophisticated models. And for the people wondering why hasn't he mentioned the weather API yet, I will come to that in a minute. But first, let me explain something about the models that we use. That's the next slide. So we use sophisticated models that take many so-called features of this data into account. For example, the size of the discharges, correlations between different data points. And here comes the weather API, because what we found is that actually these discharges, they correlate very well with temperature. And we investigated this using the weather API because it turned out to be extremely easy to load this data. We could load many different kinds of temperatures at different heights, and also underground, which seemed to be the most relevant for our application, because the cables are also underground. And it was very easy to do this analysis, because the data was so easily available. So the next slide, I will go in depth, but just to finish this slide, next to correlations, we also look at the shape of the distributions. We look at statistical features and also changes in correlations or in, for example, charges. So we construct many features that have predictive value for faults. And now I will come to the weather API. Yes, so tomorrow, one of my students will actually graduate on the topic of the predictive value of the weather on failures. And he looked at a lot of data from the smart cable grid system, but also from the weather API. And what he found is that there were highly significant correlations between temperature and these discharges. And you can already see it happening in the picture here. So the red line is the temperature at 1 meter depth, that's around cable depth. And the blue dots are actually the sparks, the partial discharge at this location. And you see, once the temperature drops, the sparks occur. And this is not one example. We see this happening a lot of times. And this is actually related probably to some failure mechanism of a particular type of joint. So if you can create some features out of this phenomena, which is what Mees van Os did, you can actually improve the models that we use to predict failure. And he actually showed that if you use these features, you can improve the model by 20%. Maybe I need to explain what 20% means. This, in this case, means that you get 20% a reduction in false alerts. And that's for us very important, because that's what we try to automate, the number of cases that a human needs to interpret manually, which is a very expensive exercise, but because it takes hours and hours to do all this work. And we were very happy with this result, and we're also implementing it now in our production system, so that we continuously use the API to try to prevent faults. And hopefully in a short time, we can actually give some concrete examples where we actually prevented faults using the system. But I don't expect we have to wait long for that. That was what I wanted to say today. So any questions about this topic?
Everyone is flabbergasted by those great results. No questions in the chats. So I guess for now we'll move on. Thank you, Sander. Thank you, Johan. I think you both finished your part. Looking at Johan too.
I think so too. Let's figure out on the next slide.
Next slide is open source, so that's mine.
Okay. Then yes. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you both. If you have any further questions for Sander or for Johan, please feel free to drop them in the chat and we'll answer them there. So the line open source has been dropped quite a few times now, so I will now move on to explain to you what open source is. Maybe some of you will know, but we will dive into that anyway. Let me see. Well, software, as you might know, consists of source code. And open source software, for those of you that do not know, is software of which the source code is freely available. So you may use it, you may change it, you may redistribute it, as long as you stay within the limits that the license of the code prescribes. Normally, when a company produces apps, for example, the source code remains private because they've built something great that they're proud of, and no one can know how. Otherwise, everyone will do the same and steal your idea. And there it goes, your strategic advantage. Or does it? Open source software, as I said before, is freely available. You can find it online. So why do people do that? And why does Alexander participate in open source? Well, for us, and I think many share the idea, is that open source enables you to collaborate easily with others. You share knowledge, you share time, because you're working on the same project, essentially. You do have to negotiate where you're going to take the project, but there's much benefit to doing things together instead of apart. As said before, the energy transition does not end at country borders, so we need to work together and share the smart solutions that we have in order to achieve more. And there's one example I would like to share with you that I love in explaining the benefits of open source software to people. One of our partners, RTE, which is a French network company, was going to build exactly what we already built in the past couple of years. So we heard about that and we talked about it. And by open sourcing our code, they put their money and energy and efforts in advancing and improving our source code instead of reinventing the wheel, which, well, makes benefits for both of us. Well, as I said, by investing in open source software, as Alexander, we are giving something back to the community, hoping for investment in return, so that together we can meet the challenges of the energy transition. Alexander is also part of the Linux Foundation Energy, which enables us to work together internationally. The Linux Foundation has a lot of members, which all face the same problems, as I said. The Linux Foundation is an organization that brings people and organizations together in order to be able to work together as well. They've been a great help in getting us on track, and they play a large role in connecting us to others that have, as I said, the same ambitions and plans. We also started an open source program office, which I'm a part of. The open source program office is an organization, you might say, within Oleander. We help open source projects get started, to connect with LF Energy, to organize webinars such as this. And we also try to ground the open source culture within Oleander's identity, because it's very much a behavioral change instead of just saying, oh, now we do open source and then that's it. It's asked for a different approach, and we're trying to teach our developers and our people to adopt that that strategy. So why did we open source this project? It's a handy tool, which we saw before, and we feel more people can benefit, even outside the energy world. By open sourcing the code, we hope that others will check it out to fix bugs, perhaps, or help us along. As Johan said before, to add a weather source from Belgium or Germany, whichever you need. Everything might make us better, and we can work along together. So we're very much looking forward to that, and perhaps this webinar might be a start of that. Let me see. Next slide is our invitation for you to check out the project's website and GitHub, on which you can find the code. Source code, or to use the API itself, which is the final link on the slide. As we said, you can find the API online on our website and on the README at GitHub. So. Feel free to take a look and to learn more about the API itself. So I think that's it for the first part. We're quite a bit faster than we thought, but that's fine. Are there any questions so far regarding open source or the API, how to use it? I think none so far. Nico, my colleague, has posted the link to the website and to GitHub in the chat. Thank you for that. I will propose that we have a break, short break, and continue at 5 o'clock sharp. I can see a question from Edwin. Any real-time data? Can you expand a bit on that, or perhaps Johan knows immediately what you mean. Data from today.
Well, how old is the data? I can imagine we are looking for data from today. We have a real-time data platform. We collect energy data, and we would like to compare that real-time with the current weather situation. Is that included?
I'll give the floor to you, or no?
I'll pick up this question. Yes, as a matter of fact, there is from the KNMI. We have actuele waarnemingen, which includes information that is updated every 10 minutes. So that's about as actual as you can get. As far as I know. Besides that, it basically depends on the model in question. We've got models that predict data. We've got models that go back to 1979 in the case of the climate data store. Some of the data of the KNMI also goes back to the 60s, depending on the weather station in question. So it all depends on the source in question. All of the weather models that are made can also give you some metadata on what is in there and how it is originally formatted and where it originally came from. So you can use the basic commands from sources and models on the site to also get some basic information on what is in every data set and is it something I could use for what I want to use it for.
Okay, thank you.
That's a clear answer.
Perfect. Any other questions? Feel free to ask them. We do have more time for questions after the technical part, so you're welcome to ask them then.
I'm sorry, I have a question. I don't want to eat into the break, of course. I really love the work you've done. I'm Wim from KNMI, so we're very happy that you have built an API on top of our data. Mm-hmm. We're also busy ourselves figuring out which APIs would fit our users best, which is of course broader than this community, but you are a very big part of the community as well, of course. And we are looking mostly at OGC services, the Open Geospatial Consortium. Is that in any way known in your community, these type of standardized APIs? Because if not, then we should start looking at other initiatives.
We have heard of those. I'm not too familiar with them myself, I'll have to admit.
This is this question, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's it is an upcoming let me put this, it's upcoming news that I have been monitoring, at least myself. So it's definitely something we're keeping track of, but it's not something we've currently used in relation to the weather provider API itself.
Okay, we are one of the things we are will be doing in the next quarter is integrating the WMS functionality, the web mapping service, so you can get a gridded map of weather data, mm-hmm. or other data, wind data for as a start. So that might be of interest for you to look at. But we'll definitely check out your API and see how we can find a way to cooperate.
Mm-hmm. Gladly.
That's great. Thank you,
Lynn. I was browsing through the source code and I was wondering why the occurrence of ERA 5T data is considered rare, because in my experience, it's not rare at all. It throws in a big exception. Is that something you're aware of, or am I looking at the wrong things?
ERA 5T data is not per se an exception in meteorological data. There is data that gets reprocessed later on. That does happen quite a bit. Within the current data sets, it is one of the few locations where we have to take it into account. And that's because the CDS data takes quite a while to download and, not actually even format. It's basically the downloading itself that takes up most of the time. Which means that it's one of the few pieces of information we store in a repository right now. Which also means we have temporary data in the repository set itself. And this is basically one of the few cases where we have to reprocess temporary data with more permanent data as it comes available.
Yeah, it's indeed, it can be a pain. I have encountered it myself, and also that the format in which they mark the ERA 5T data has changed. I see the Expert 5 version, but I have also seen _0005 as suffixes to the column names.
Mm-hmm.
No idea why they don't describe.
Well, I don't know if this is the cause of it. I do know that if you happen to open a set of data in tools like Panoply, I'm hoping I pronounced that correctly, it does tend to divide the data to keep it a bit more, let's say, single indexed. by separating it into zero and five values. So it could be just a matter of that, to keep it a bit more, I won't say two-dimensional, but more unilaterally indexed. But I do know that the CDS data usually tries to forward itself, at least in that CDF format, as a multi-indexed file system.
Now I'll have to play around with it because I have a interesting application for it in mind. So I'll see what happens. And if I encounter issues, then I'll let you know if I get up.
Sounds good. Great work. Thanks. All right. I think those are the questions, and otherwise we'll have time after the second part. I will propose that we have a break until 5 past, which is 6 minutes. I guess that's enough to get a cup of coffee if you need one. And then we'll go ahead with the second part and dive into the technique and have more questions if you have any. So feel free to leave for a bit, and then we'll see each other at 5 past. Thanks for now. All right, well, welcome back. I hope you're all refreshed and ready to dive into the techniques behind the API. So Raoul, I'll give you the floor and just tell me when to click and I'll move forward. You're still on mute, so sorry. It had to happen once.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can start by clicking. My name is Raoul Lindebank, and my name is the name you'll currently see most on top of all of the comments on GitHub. That's because I'm currently the main developer for the API. And I'll try and give you a small dip into the workings of the API from the inside. To do that, I'll start out by explaining the base source and model classes used to handle weather models in a hierarchical way, followed by telling a bit of information about repositories and how they work. Then some in-depth about Xray datasets and why those were used in the making of this API, directly followed by the NetCDF4 data format we used to store information on disk. And finally, a bit of a demonstration of how that works in practice. Moving on to the next slide. It all starts with the weather model. The weather model is a class that holds the full working of a single weather source with a single weather data set, I'd rather say, with a number of free basic functions for interface. Next. These are the get weather function. The get weather function has the sole purpose of handling everything from getting the weather and transforming it into Xray dataset, and dealing with anything that might come in between. In the case of asynchronous models, that might be anything from handling tickets to checking the situation. Then there is the convert names and units function. That is the core for transforming data in between different formats and units. It's capable of switching both between all the new names, original formats, and the unit systems we've seen, as well as there's a function that basically just returns whether or not the model in question is asynchronous or not, which is used to properly identify to the API itself. Next, one step up. Multiple weather models are gathered under a single weather source. Getting back to the example of KNMI. Weather model, we have daily data in the form of daggegevens. We have hourly data as well in the form of uurgegevens. Both of these can be located under the weather source KNMI. KNMI as the weather source has its own metadata and its own methods. Next. Besides directly giving access to specific weather models through the getModel function, there's also a function that retrieves all of the models that apply, allowing you to get information on all the available models and their metadata. And finally, on the top level of the API, there is the weather controller. Weather controller checks multiple sources and their models, and it grants a bit more direct access using a lot of direct access functions. Just like with weather source, it can access sources and their details. It can directly access models and their details, as well as provide a shortcut to the model's get weather function by using a shorthand implementation in which you call model name and source name to directly access the weather model's get weather function. And the same goes for the convert names and units function. Together, yep, that forms the API's main functionality. Besides that, we also have repositories. Sometimes we need to store data. We want to keep that as flexible as possible. And even though it is the main objective to store as little data as possible, sometimes you have to. And the weather repository base model is the main source of that. The weather repository base also provides interface using only three core functions. There's the update function, which handles periodical or targeted updates for the repository in question. There's the cleanup function, which checks for any inconsistencies and allows for cleanup of specific files. And the gather period function, which retrieves a specific period into a XRA dataset to immediately provide relief for the related weather model. A small jump back towards this picture. And as you can see, we gather weather, we convert it to a XRA dataset, then we convert the units and labels, and eventually we get to the formatted end result. XRA dataset is the sole type that's mentioned here by name, and that's because every single piece of weather data gets loaded into XRA dataset at a given moment in time, either before delivering it or once again after loading it from disk. Why have we used XRA datasets? Well, there's a number of reasons for that. The first one of this is next, please. It supports multi-indexation with easy options to flatten data if this is required. You cannot only store data in multiple dimensions, you can also do this with multiple indexations. You can easily store it and load it indeed using NetCDF4 without any need for conversion, because the VeriXRA dataset format is based on NetCDF4. Next. It can easily be altered or converted and formatted without even getting the code convoluted, because there is a lot of functionality in there that both allows for transactions, calculations, and even transformation in the form of dropping variables or even entire dimensions without getting into pieces of code that easily supersede 20, 50 lines of code. And all of those are being brought back to one or two lines to keep things easy and clear. Why then the NetCDF4 format for storage? The first one you've already heard. There's an easy and smooth interaction with XRA datasets, allowing the multi-index storage we use in memory to directly transfer to file. So even if we need to store things multi-index, multi-dimensional, complicated, we can easily save it and then load it back before transforming it into the format we need without any loss of complexity. It is also already a current day standard used and supported by quite a number of applications. Quite a number of the sources we use also support NetCDF4. CDS supports NetCDF4. I believe one of the the KNMI data source we use as well is also available in NetCDF. Panapply is a tool that is regularly used to visualize weather data. This also officially supports NetCDF as well as GRIP. And finally, it's an actual file format. We did look at GRIP 1 and 2 for file storage. The main downside for GRIP 1 and 2 is that it is not actually a file format as much as it is a description of records that can be saved as a file. Downside to that is both that compound GRIP files can get extremely complex to read and format. And it also doesn't naturally support compression outside of any given specific format you store it as. NetCDF out of the box can be compressed based on specific indexation and request purposes, allowing us to bring files back in the case of Harmony and Rome from 1.2 gigabyte file size to about 200 MBs without losing any of the speed in requesting data. Next. In practice, what does it look like? Any kind of gathering conversion translates into a request. The request ends up at the weather model, and the weather model returns a harmonized result. Harmonization itself basically takes a harmonized result, uses a request to transform that into a specific format and file format if required. Space, over next. what does this look like in the API? start out with the same basic functions, except when we connect those together. Next. In the API shell, and once more, I believe. Yeah. basically, the API connects both of these requests together using the weather controller, allowing you to basically say, I want to call a specific source and a specific model. The controller basically formats that into a specific request for a specific model, accesses that model and its getWeather method, gets back the Xray dataset, then uses a convert name and units to format that into the appropriate naming and unit schedule, and finally returns it as the requested file. Next.
This one or the next one?
Well, this all, of course, can be handled by any kind of requesting party, as the weather controller itself basically handles all of the requests and forwards those to the proper sources and models using the API's file structure. And from thereupon out, it basically is basically becomes a very flexible, easy system. Next. Yeah, I'm going on a small jump to the side on something that's not on the slides for now, because I basically wanted to add that a bit earlier on. Yeah, the system we use for models, sources, and the weather controller itself was also built, that may not have been entirely clear, to be as scalable as possible. That means that you can use the weather model by itself, you can use the weather source by itself, with the models, of course, hooked up to it, and you can use the weather controller separately, depending on the product you want to use. You can deploy the full API for yourself, you can deploy a weather controller, you can deploy a weather source directly into a project, and you can deploy a specific weather model, allow you to easily upscale or downscale any project to properly handle the weather information you want to deal with. All of it works in the same way and with the same amount of ease. Well, if you're interested in contributing to the Weather Provider API open source project, there's a number of things you can do. First of all, there's, of course, informing people about its existence. Telling people that there is such a thing as the Weather API and what it can do breeds interest. And with it, people that start following the repository and or cooperating with the production thereof. Next. Second of all, if you encounter bugs when using it, or you have ideas or questions, these can all be put on the GitHub issues page. It's basically as the moment you basically encounter something you don't like, something you do like, something you would like better, and something you just miss out there, it can be put up on the issues board. All of those issues will be answered as fast as possible, depending, of course, on the amount of time available. And finally, if you want to step it up a bit further, you can fork the project for yourself, create your own improvements, fixes, enhancements, or even reworks of modules, and then forward those back using pull requests. This allows people to basically turn the Weather API project into something they want to use themselves, adding new features, adding new models, and that kind of stuff. And then transferring those into a pull request. Your technical people, if you're not technical people yourself, should know what a pull request is. will then be capable of forwarding that code back to the main project. Besides that, not on this slide, there is, of course, an option to deepen your connection with the project itself, becoming a part of it. If you're interested in that, you can just contact the people associated with the project and we'll work from there. Next. And that's basically the main setup of the technical details. It's a bit short, but I thought let's not head too much into details because that'll get complex pretty fast. But if there are any questions about the code or the way things are handled, you can ask them now.
Yeah, I got a question. Both CDS and KNMI, I believe, they use an API with a key. Mm-hmm. Is this in the code, or do you need to provide your own API keys? I think the latter, of course.
It is, of course, the latter. If you're if you use the API as is on the Apex cloud location, an API is already provided, of course. But if you want to use the of the system for yourself, you'll need to provide your own API.
Okay.
Most of those settings can be put on the server by using environment variables or hard coded in the app configuration itself.
Okay. And I saw in the KNMI file that you still use the FTP ingestion method instead of the new API. Is that something which is about to be changed, or well, should I make a PR?
What data model are you referring
the,
to?
The Harmony ROM model.
Harmony ROM.
There's a new API endpoint from KNMI.
There is an API endpoint. As far as I know, we used that one.
I still see the FTP information in the code.
Could you refer to the code in question? Where can we find this? And that I'll check it on the go.
one moment.
If we have some time later on, Raoul, maybe you can do a short tour as well of GitHub as well, so people can see where they can find the README and stuff. I have the link on Chrome. So
it's in app/routers/weather/sources/knmi/models and then the Harmony ROM Python file. And it refers to the FTP site in line 45.
Oh, yeah, right. Yes, that's... we should probably translate that to the HTTPS location for the information on the site. It is not actually the URL that's used for... the downloading itself. In this case, it's the... The self.url is the URL used for information on the modeling question.
That's it.
The actual download function itself in this case is put in, all the way back to KNMI, then client, and then KNMI downloader.
I didn't look there. Thank you.
That one is called from the repository, which is also in that folder.
Yeah, I see it. Yeah, indeed. Good.
Okay.
Any other questions for now? Okay, maybe Raoul, you can show us something, or just. Should I give you the controls?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Does it work?
I think so.
Just a quick tour.
Making sure it works. I don't think I have it quite yet.
I don't see it moving.
Nope. It doesn't quite work. I'm asking for access myself now.
Nope, don't get the request.
Okay, I can't get controls for whatever reason.
Just tell me what it works like.
Yes, well, for starters, this is the basic GitHub interface for those who haven't seen it. The main page involves the project files, followed by the README. The README, you see it directly down there, scroll a bit down. Is the easiest way to get most of the information on the weather provider API. Usually in any project, this will give you basic information on what's in there, how it works, and how you can basically start working with the project itself. If you move up a bit. Yes. The files themselves basically handle the structure of the program. The full works for the weather provider API is inside the app directory. Please open the app directory.
Sorry, which one? Where do we? Where?
In the file browser part of the screen.
this one, I think.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
From there on, it splits out into core, routers, and versions. Versions handles API versions. Core handles the API functionality. And routers basically handles all of the weather data itself. Please click on routers. Click on weather. From there upon out, there's a number of basic information, base models, information about job handling, basic repository class, and sources contains all of the actual weather sources we use. Please click on sources. As you can see, we right now use CDS for all of the source information on CDS, KNMI, on all of the information on KNMI. And as an exception, there's also Weather Alert, which handles the KNMI Weather Alert system, which may be later on integrated into KNMI. But if you click on KNMI, we see things in practice. There's the KNMI.python file, which is actually the source class. If you click on it, we'll see that in action. The class KNMI extends the weather source base, has some basic metadata like its ID to call it with, the name of the source in question, the main link to KNMI.nl, and the self setup models feature loads, in this case, the Uurgegevens model, daggegevens model, RO model, plan model, and actuele waarnemingen model. Those models themselves, if we move to the top, we see KNMI in the, let's see, I'm just going to try and ask control once again. This might be a bit easier. Let's see if it works now. Yes.
Yeah.
The models themselves are in the model subdirectory. All of them with clear naming. And if you select one, you can see that the core of it, there's the Uurgegevens model based on weather model base. This works for all of them. The tree-like structure means that the submodels are always inside of the directory of the source, keeping things nice and hierarchical. So if you want to add something to CDS, it's basically a matter of entering CDS, entering models, and starting your new model there. Back to the main screen. As you can see, licensing information is also pretty important. Basic license information is available on the main screen. Detailed licensing information is available in licenses. And besides that, every one of these sources refers to data on the source in question, from which their license information can be gathered as well. If you wish to contribute, there is the issues tab. I'll leave that to you. Yeah. As you can see, there's already a number of 20 issues. Currently, these are related to, working on basically the next full version, which has a lot of changes upcoming on the back end, not on the front end. If you wish to make a new issue of something, you want to report something that doesn't work, you want to suggest the future, you can do it from here. There are some templates, bug reports, and feature requests. And if something you feel you need to address something that can't be done with those two, you can open a blank issue. Let's say you found a bug. It's as simple as get started. Fill in a nice title that describes what the issue in question is. And support the basically supply the information that is required here. Same thing goes for future requests. It's pretty self-explanatory. So the only thing you need to do is go to issues, start the issue, and work from there. Next to that, if you want to keep an eye on the Weather Provider API, you can watch it from here. Add it to your own personal GitHub accounts as a start repository, easy to find from here. And if you want to start your own sub fork of this, you can basically click over here and add a copy of the Weather Provider API master project to your own personal working space. I think that pretty much tells most of the important information for now on what it looks like on GitHub and where you could go for certain things. And if there are any questions about that, please ask them now.
That was a great tour.
And
more questions, I think.
And if you're interested in what's upcoming for now, this is the 3.0 current plan and activity list.
Great. Yeah. Fantastic. I say check it out when you have time.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I'll say back to finishing it up, I'd say.
Back to Hilversum.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are there any more questions for now? I just forgot, if as long as we're on the internet, I just wanted to show you the website. We have an Oleander.com website for all our open source activities. If you click on Oleander.com/open-source, you can see all our projects, why we do open source, etc. But we have a special page for the Weather Provider API, both in Dutch and English, which explains how to use the API, why this API, etc., and a link to GitHub as well. So you can find more information over there, as well as information on our other projects. So that might be nice to check out as well. Let me see. I guess we're reaching the end of the webinar, which is great. We can get to our dinner in time. For now, thank you very much for being here and for listening so attentively. As we said, we are looking for collaboration. So check out GitHub, check out the website that we showed before, and contribute to the Weather API, which would be great. Even questions are very welcome for now. The links will be available in the slides, which we will send along afterwards. So there's nothing left to say but to thank you for being present or to for listening afterwards. Feel free to reach out via GitHub or ospo@aleono.com. And well, thank you for being here again and have a great evening.